Hello and welcome back to the channel. Thank you for joining me in another of my wonderful interviews. By popular demand, I have a gentleman who is coming back, I think for the third or fourth time now. I start to lose count. Sovereign Pete. And Sovereign Pete said, I'd love to talk to you about money. We've looked at money in various different forms in the past, from lots of different contributors, but Sovereign Pete has, of course, his unique perspective on everything. Pete, welcome back to the show.
Thank you very much. Great to be here.
It's lovely to have you back. Now, before we get into the money, I know you've got an event coming up, which you've told me about, called the Sovereign Conference, Sovereign Project Conference.
Yep.
And here it is. Take possession of your sovereignty. And I think more than any other time, that is something that we most definitely need to do. Can you just give us a brief outline of what that is all about?
Sure, no problems. Obviously, the Sovereign Project, we deal with the mindset first, and then we help you with language and also your paperwork. In fact, you did something today about spell and how words are spells and they can trick you, that sort of stuff. So we show people how this is done to them. Okay. So the Sovereign event that we've put together, this conference, is to help other sovereigns connect. So it's part of networking. We're growing the network. And it's also for those who want to become sovereign and people who are struggling with the mindset, people who feel like they've still got the slave mentality and they want to get rid of it. Mm. So I'll be doing a presentation throughout the day. And there are free teas and coffees available. It's going to be a sit-down event. Obviously, there's tables and stuff. We have a specialist who will be there called Trina Deacon, and she will be going through information regarding trusts, and she will explain how to protect your assets with the upcoming possible reset that's coming, if you know what I mean. Mm. And I'll have some other guests there, which will be, I've got some of my team members there that run workshops over, all around the country. They'll be there as well to help with the audience's questions. So it should be a good day. We did one last year, and by popular demand, we've been asked to do another one, and we said, okay, we'll do another one. And there's only 100 tickets, by the way. It's limited to only 100, so you can't just turn up. It's ticket
right.
only.
And it's the first, just looking here, Sunday the 1st of October.
Yep.
And it's located outside Colville, just outside Leicester.
Yes,
it
is.
Or it's located in Colville, just outside Leicester, for those of you, which is up in Midlands.
Aye, it is.
Right, lad. So bring your whippet. Oh, it's not quite Yorkshire, is it?
We're not quite Yorkshire.
No. But you see, the trouble with me is I'm based down on the south coast, so anywhere north of the South Downs is going up north.
Up north.
I love it. So I'm coming along. It's very kind of you to let me come along. So it'd be great to meet everyone. And as you say, just building a network of sovereign people, I think, is so laudable and it has to be done.
Yes. It is happening.
Difficult times.
It is happening. I think we get about 10 people a day signing up to the Sovereign Project now. So we want to get those numbers up. We want it to be 100 people a day, then 1,000, and then we can get things done then.
Yeah. The more sovereign people there are in this world, the better it is as we understand what is lawful and what is legal and all of those things. So we're going to talk about money.
Yes.
Because we've had many guests on talking about money from tokens, money from the difference between money and currency. We've looked at alternative money. There's your crypto money, Bitcoin, and other things. And I think there's something called XRP or PRX or something that's in the pipeline. I've heard about that. I think Gavin was talking about from Sovereign
Empowerment. Yeah.
So there's so many different things. So I'm interested on your understanding and ideas of money.
Yeah, no problem. I'm going to try and explain it quite simply. And I'm going to try and... Yes. I'm not going to use any technical terminology.
Right.
And we might have a few thought experiments along the way so that everyone who's following along, they can play this game as well, okay?
Fantastic.
And I want to start at the very beginning. You see, I think where people go wrong is they get into this argument, what is money and crypto and all the rest of it, but they land in the middle of the argument and then they don't know which direction to turn and then they get all confused. Mm. So I think what we should do is start at the very beginning and before there was even money, because money is an invention. Okay, so it was invented.
Yes.
It's one of the most powerful inventions ever. I mean, I would say it was probably the second most powerful invention created. First would be the wheel. And then the second one after that, I would say, would be the gun. Then it would be the internal combustion engine, the printing press, money, not in that particular order. And then the internet. These are very powerful inventions.
Inventions that really change things.
Yes, they did. Absolutely. And they can be used for good and evil, by the way.
Of
So,
course.
there's a good side to both. So let's start with the basics, with early barter, because I know there's a lot of talk within the freedom movement about bartering, and maybe that's a solution. So I'm going to do like a thought experiment here to try and understand, to try and get people to understand how barter works. So consider you got two cavemen on a desert island, okay? Nog and Og, if you wish, okay? One of them's a fisherman. And he swims out from the shore and he catches a few fish. Okay, so he spends his whole day catching the fish. And then he comes back to the shore. Now you've got the other caveman, okay, and he spends his day making baskets. So he makes two baskets all day long out of grass. He collects the grass and straw and he stitches them up and he makes a couple of baskets. Okay, so the fisherman. He's spent all day, 12, 18 hours fishing, and it's been a long, whole day, but he's got about 10 fish. And he's trying to carry his fish, and he's going, all these fish, they're slipping out my hands. I'm dropping them, and all this sort of stuff. I could do with a basket, that'd be really handy. And then he notices another caveman who's made a basket. He's got two of them. So then he goes over and says, okay, I would like one of your baskets, please. And the other caveman says, okay, well, I'm actually quite hungry. And I wouldn't mind some of your fish. Okay, so you've got these two cavemen. There's no other people on this desert island. Okay, one's got 10 fish and the other one's got two baskets. Okay, one's very hungry and the other one doesn't have a basket to carry his fish. So they're going to exchange some items here. So if the fisherman has 10 fish and the basket maker's got two baskets, how much is one basket?
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? Because you could say, on the face of it, share and share alike, 50%, five fish to a basket.
That's what I would go with. That's what I would go with. Both men have spent the whole day doing their job, okay? And I would say that would be a fair trade. So the fisherman would say, okay, then I will give you five fish for the basket, and the basket then goes to the fisherman. Now, what this does is it actually creates wealth for both men, so both cavemen, because now the fisherman, he's got his five fish in a basket. He says, I can't eat 10 fish anyway because they'll go rotten. Now I've got a lovely basket, I can now carry my fish. I'm great. The basket maker, he says, great, not a problem, I've got my fish to eat, so I'm not hungry anymore, and I've got my own basket, you see, so he's good to go. So what's actually happened is these two people have bartered and exchanged, and their independent wealths have both increased, okay? Because the basket maker, he perceives the value of the fish higher than his basket. And then the fisherman, he perceives the value of the basket higher than the fish he's got, because he's got 12, 10 fish anyway, so he doesn't need them. So the both their wealth goes up. Now, what happens if the fisherman has 12 fish? How much is a basket? And
Well,
two baskets.
yeah, well, presumably it's six fish.
Six fish.
It's still half of, because it's you're dividing it in
Yes,
half.
absolutely correct. So now it's six fish per basket. And then you go, okay, then what happens if the basket maker has made three baskets? There's some mass in play now. So what's
Yes.
three into 12? Well, that would be four, wouldn't it?
Hmm.
So it would be four fish for one basket. Have we just created price?
Well, that's true, isn't it? That's I think we have.
Yes. Now, if you notice, we've just created price with no governments, that there's no monarchy, there's no rules, there's no regulations. Two cavemen on a desert island have been able to figure this out for themselves.
Yes.
Okay, so this is basic barter, and this is how price operates, okay? Because both parties can negotiate to consider what is fair. So this is the foundation of the monetary system that we'll get into in a bit. Now, one of the key issues here, this is something you have to understand, the contract has been concluded. So once the fish have been exchanged for the money, Sorry, for the baskets. The basket have been exchanged. The two cavemen can go their own separate ways. The contract's concluded. There is no outstanding debt. There is no outstanding contract in any way, shape, or form. That's it. It's done. So that's early barter. So hopefully everyone can understand that, and they can understand how price works now, because that's quite easy to understand.
Can I just ask one thing on that? Is, let's say that there was another basket maker or another fisherman, just to upset the basket, so to speak, or the balance. Presumably the price, you've now got competition in whichever way it is. But ultimately, you're going to come to some agreement.
Yes. In fact, we were going to cover that in... I've got notes this time. So
oh, I see. I'm so sorry. I'm jumping ahead. I do apologize.
Absolutely. We're going to cover cooperation and competition.
All right. Well, I'll wait patiently like a good boy.
It's a fair question, absolutely. But what we need to get into is skill specialization.
Right.
This is the next stage of barter, okay? So I'm taking everybody on this easy-to-understand journey, okay? And hopefully we'll get to the end of this thought experiment, if you like, and we'll cover everything. Mm. Now, let's say the fisherman, he's going, right, okay, it's taking me 18 hours a day. You know, I'm out there with my pointy stick and I'm in the shallows. I can only swim so far and it's really hard work and I can only get the small fish. Mm. So he goes, now, if I had a boat and a sail and a net and perhaps someone to help me, I could sail out to sea and get the really big fish and only spend 2 or 3 hours fishing and then come back and have the rest of the day to myself. Now, here's the problem. He could try and build his own boat. That means chopping trees down, making the wood, and all the rest of it. And he's going, well, I have to fish, because if I don't fish, I'm going to go hungry. Mm. It's going to take me too long to make the boat and the sails. So this is why he goes, now there's a few more people on this desert island. We've got a bit of a village going. So he goes into the village and he goes, look, I really could do with a boat. I need some wood. So that one of the villagers says, well, I can chop down trees and I can actually make the wood for you. And I know Fred over there, he can actually make boats as well. So you go, okay. So the fisherman says, well, can I give you some fish for some wood? And he goes, yeah, great. That barter's now working. Okay. So then he gets the wood and he goes to Fred. He says, Fred, can you make me a boat? And you say to Fred, would you like some fish? And he goes, yes, I would. Oh, fantastic. This is really working out very well. Now, he might need a sail. He might need a net. He needs someone to work for him and help with the net. Now, eventually, he'll meet someone. He goes, he might need the sail stitching. Okay. Mm. So he goes to the person who's going to make the sail, who's specialized in making sails. And he goes, would you like some fish for a sail? And he goes, well, no, I don't like fish. And then you go, oh, okay, we've got a bit of a problem now because he's a fish.
Scuppered his plan.
Yes.
So far.
So there's a bit of a problem, isn't he?
Yeah.
So what happens is that this is the limitations of barter. Mm. Because the fisherman has a problem. He wants the sail for his boat, but he can't actually get the sail because the salesperson doesn't want the fish. Now, this is what is called the double coincidence of wants problem. All right. So I'll say that again. The double coincidence of wants problem. This is
of wants, as in W-A-N-T.
Yes.
Where
you want something.
You want something. Right.
Yeah. So in our first experiment or thought experiment, the basket weaver wanted fish and the fisherman wanted a basket. So they both want what each other has. So the barter can actually happen. Now, the problem with this is that if the other person doesn't want the fish, then the barter process breaks down, because now the fisherman's got to go to the salesman, sail maker, say, well, what is it you want? And he goes, well, I could do some needles. Right. And then, of course, the fisherman goes, oh, okay, then I'm going to go to the needle maker and says, can I have some needles for your fish? And the needle maker goes, well, no, I don't want any fish. And he goes, oh, no, well, what do you want then? He goes, well, I could do with some bread. He goes, all right, then I'll go to the baker and I'll try and get the baker to swap. You see the problem? It goes like that.
Yeah, yeah. And he can have a long list before he gets to satisfy everybody.
That's right. That's right. And he's now wasting a lot of time on this. Yeah. So this is where the problem of barter is seen.
Yeah.
Now, try and think about your own personal life today. Okay. Try and think about what it is in your life you have, all your belongings, you know, your house, your van, you've got a microphone there, I can see, all this stuff. that you have, you know, got a camera that's recording this.
Hopefully.
Hopefully, if you press record.
Yeah.
Now, think how many people were involved in creating all of this stuff for you.
Mm. Okay?
And then you've got to try and barter with each and every one of them.
You couldn't do it.
Couldn't do it. You can't do it. In fact, if you think about it, almost everything in your house, think about your house is being built, you've got the bricks that make your house. Well, someone has to make those bricks. So there's got to be a company that makes the bricks, and they've got to get the raw materials. They've got to go to a miner, and the miner's got to get the raw materials. It goes on and on and on and on. And in fact, if you think about it, it's like you look around your whole house, everything you own, you will probably find that everyone on the planet has had a hand in making what it is you've got now.
Well, that's very kind of them. I'd like to thank them all very much. Could I have a newer version of it all, please?
And this is the problem. This is how, you know, let's say there's 8 billion people on the planet, depending on the source, it might not be, but let's give it a figure. How are you supposed to deal with those individual people and barter on? You can't, it's impossible.
No.
So the limitations of barter is just that. Okay, you can't expand and you can't create any more wealth. So we'll get into money. Okay, so money was invented to solve this problem. Okay, now the way money works is that it's very similar to barter. Okay, so think about the fish and the baskets. And, you know, you might trade the fish with the bread maker, and you might trade a basket with the sail maker or someone like that. Okay, this is barter. However, when money was invented, and it was not created by governments and monarchs and kings or anything like that, it was the people who invented it. Okay, this is comes from the free market. What money is, it's something of intrinsic value, okay, a commodity that is the same on each trade. So you've got a trade, okay, so it's fish, but instead of for a basket, it's now money. And let's say, let's call it a gold coin. And then the basket will be traded for a gold coin, and the bread will be traded for a gold coin, okay? And the sail will be traded for a gold coin. So that is all that money is. All it is barter, but on one side of that barter is exactly the same for everybody, okay? So now we're moving on. So this is the value of money. Now, what everyone is using is money, such as gold. So this is like, it's still barter, but one side of barter is actually money at this point. This creates a stable market. Now, the power of this is that every individual within this market can now have a say, their own individual say, on what the price of something is. Okay, because they all can decide. So let's expand on this. And then it can be a cup of coffee. Okay, so let's say someone's trying to sell a cup of coffee for £10,000 or something like this. No one's going to buy that because it's too expensive, because I can get a cup of coffee for £2.50. So everyone has a say. And this is where price stability comes into place. It's all of us deciding on how we spend our money that determines the price of the commodity that's out there on the market. Now, when you understand how that works, now we can talk about upscaling. This is very powerful, okay? So upscaling is, now we've gone past bartering, we understand how that works, we understand how price works now, because that's very simplistic. Now, you don't need a degree in economics to understand how price works. Now, we now understand what money is. It's a commodity that everybody shares on one side of the trade. This creates a free market with everyone deciding on the price of goods. Now we can upscale on a massive scale. So what this means is people can specialize, okay? So you can just, they can just focus on one particular job, and everyone can have a say on what the value of that job is. Now, this is where we get into cooperation and competition, which is what you mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
Now, for the most part, within a free market, people cooperate, okay? So you'll have different businesses all working together, like the fisherman, he wants his boat. So that fisherman will work with different people who cooperate together, okay, and they will create the boat for him, and the nets and the sails, and someone will work for him, working in cooperation. Now, also within a free market is what is called competition. Now, competition is absolute vital. It is absolute key. Okay, competition forces people to improve what it is they're already doing.
Okay. Yeah, because there is an alternative if they don't.
Exactly right. Exactly right. So let's say the basket weaver, he was doing a terrible job. He was going, I've got the market on baskets. No one else on this village is making baskets. So I can be a bit slapdash and there's holes in it and the handles fall off and it's not very good. But what are you going to do? Because I'm selling baskets. No one else does. Well, if someone says, I'm going to start making baskets as well, but I'm going to make them out of leather and I'm going to put some brass bits on it and all the rest of it.
Yeah,
that's the competition. So for the old basket weaver to stay in business, he's got to up his game. Okay. So for cooperation and competition is absolutely important within an economy. Okay. This is now an economy. It's now expanding. Now, what I want to try and get into, hopefully everyone understands that's not difficult to follow.
No. And in the cooperation, we're talking about people are being, they're giving their time or their skill in exchange for these, whatever the money is, the gold coins.
Yes, absolutely.
At that point, yeah.
Now, what I might do is I might cover the shared economy, price versus value, and then we'll get into actually what money is.
But right,
it will all make sense because I'm giving you the information to begin with. So when I explain to people what money is, they'll totally understand it. And they go, yeah, I now understand what money is. But yeah, basically money is, it has two intrinsic properties. One is labor and one is a commodity of value. That's what makes money. But we'll go into that in a bit.
Yeah, sure.
So I just want to touch on a shared economy. Okay, so we're just going off on a tangent a little bit because there's a lot of people in the freedom movement, truth movement, if you will, saying, well, we could have a shared economy. Well, the problem with sharing is it limits growth of the economy. Okay, and it actually starts making things more expensive. And this is why people don't understand. Now, you can share things on a limitation, a limited basis. It's not a problem. You know, I share things with my friends and family, you know, borrow my land, you know, lawnmower. It's not a problem. But if everyone did that, then there would be no market for lawnmowers. So right, let me explain how this would work. So within a shared economy, if you can't have a shared economy without a free market that uses money. It's the free market that uses money that creates the wealth for all. Okay. Now, if you bring in the shared economy, what tends to happen is the price goes up for everything. Now, let me explain. Let's say there's 100,000 people in a village. Okay.
And it's a big village then.
It's a big village. It's a big village. Yeah. We're upscaling now. So this.
Oh, yes, of course.
This,
so, yeah.
This desert island is now a small island. It's a larger island now.
Yeah.
So there's 100,000 people in this village. And they've got houses and all the rest of it. And they have need for a set of ladders. Okay, so they want some ladders. Now, I could be a businessman and I go, oh, actually, I've got a market here. I've got 100,000 people. And they all want, or some of them want to buy ladders. They've got the use for ladders. So I can set up a business. So I might rent out a building and I'll hire some staff. And I'll buy in some raw materials, some aluminium, some tools and all the rest of it. And I start making ladders. Okay, now that might cost me £1 million to set up. But I'm also going to sell 10,000 ladders to this market. And I might sell each ladder for, I don't know, £100 or something like that. Okay, so I should get my money back and I make a bit more on top, £120 or something like that. Now, as long as 10,000 people buy my ladders, I'm going to be okay. And as long as 10,000 people buy my ladders, each set of ladders is only going to be £100 or something like that. But if I don't have that market, and there isn't 10,000 customers, and there's only one, and there's only one person who wants to buy a set of ladders, and he's going to share it with everybody.
Mm.
Guess how much that set of ladders has now become?
£1 million.
£1 million.
But it's very nice, £1 million worth of ladders.
Oh, it's going to be great, isn't it? But you'll only have the one set.
Yeah, that can be used at only one time.
That's right. That's right. That's the limitations, you see. So you can't do the share, a shared economy, because obviously it's £1 million set of ladders. So this is why you need a free market using money. And the more people who buy that particular item lowers the actual item value, if you like. So that helps people. So let's talk about price versus value. All right. So a lot of people get confused on this as well, because politicians will use this and they'll cause arguments. And they'll do this. They did this during the 70s to destroy industry in the UK. You know, we used to have a thriving car market here. We were one of the leaders in building and selling cars. Now we've lost that, or the UK has. And this was done by the politicians basically saying the workers were worth more. And what it was is that the politicians would put the value on the person themselves, like saying you're worth more than that, rather than the work that they were doing. So we have to separate these two things, okay?
Right.
So let's say, for example, again, this is very easy to follow. Let's say you've got a garden outside and the grass is very long and you could do with it mowing. You say, I could do with someone cutting my lawn. And you're willing to give someone a six-pack of beer for doing it. It'll take an hour, okay? Now, I could do that. I can go, okay, I'll take that. I'll do it for a six-pack of beer and I'll mow your lawn. Or maybe Tom Cruise pulls up outside your house.
Hello, Tom. He normally drops in through the roof, doesn't he, to be fair, on the end of the helicopter.
Yeah, on his cable.
Yeah.
So Tom Cruise pulls up outside your house in his Bugatti Veyron.
Yeah.
And he's towing a lawnmower on the back of it. And he goes, hey, Rich. He goes, I understand that you're in the market to have your garden mowed. And
absolutely.
You go, yes, I am, Tom.
He's come for the cocktails. That's what he's come for.
So then Tom goes, oh, well, I'll do it for you because I'm starting up my business now, mowing lawns. And so he gets his lawnmower off his Bugatti Veyron.
Hollywood's not been so good to him. You've got to feel sorry for him.
So he mows your lawn, takes him an hour, he knocks on your door. And he goes, okay, Richard. He says, I've done that. He says, I want 50,000 beers from you.
Oh, I'll just look in the fridge, mate. Do you know, it's only a small fridge. You're hoping, aren't you, Tom?
Yes, exactly. That's what you'd say. You'd go, whoa, what do you mean 50,000? It says I'll give someone a six-pack of beer for that.
Yeah.
And Tom Cruise says, yeah, but I'm Tom Cruise. I'm worth more than that. But then you'd turn around and say, maybe, but cutting my lawn isn't worth that.
Yes.
So you see where the value and the price is. So it's the value in the work done, not the person who's doing it. Okay.
Except I'm just gonna the little mind goes here and says, oh, but if Banksy had cut your lawn and had done a little motif in it, you could then arguably say this is a piece of art, and if any fool is stupid enough to pay it, you could do it. But that's, I guess, a big exception. That if you're able, if you were able to somehow market that person, Tom Cruise cutting your lawn, and say, well, I've got a video of Tom Cruise cutting my lawn.
There you go. That's right.
It's got to be worth something. So you're selling something on the back of it in and of it to try and make your money back. Because otherwise, you're right. The actual cutting of the lawn is whatever the lowest rate, I suppose, or whatever, to a certain quality.
Yes. Yes, you got it. You got it. I mean, that's exactly right. I mean, that's right. You can say, hang on, Tom Cruise, what are you adding to this? You know, all I want you to is to mow my lawn. Now, if Tom Cruise says, yeah, well, I've just made a film and I filmed myself doing it and we're going to turn it into Mission Impossible 12, then you go, okay, then.
It must have been an extensive lawn. You'll never do that in a day, Tom. It's impossible. Dun, 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 dun.
Exactly.
Da da da.
Yes.
And I hope people at home are laughing with us.
Well, I'm hoping everyone gets it. Everyone watching, I hope they get it now.
So yeah.
It's when you say the price of something, okay, it isn't the person doing it per se.
Right.
It is the value of the job done. That's what the value is, okay? So it doesn't matter who mows your lawn. It could be me or it could be Tom Cruise, but it's the same price. It's a six-pack of beer.
Right.
Okay.
I mean, we do have on the cusp this whole thing with AI and robotics, which takes away the human element and will reduce that to the point where who knows what the price, does seem to me that you have a race to the bottom with competition.
Yes, you can. It can go too far. Well, let's go back to the competition thing. Competition in a free market is almost like self-regulating. You can't have a monopoly in a free market. It can't exist, okay? Because the powers of the market will actually destroy that, any monopoly. You can only have monopolies where there's a government. Right? They control the market. That's what they do. This is what they do with regulation. So you've got a government, which is a corporation, that has seized the market.
Yeah.
So what they've done is they've seized the market. It's no longer a free market now. Okay. They've
like energy and oil and things like that.
Everything. Everything today is controlled, no matter what it is. Production of cars, oil mining, internet access, you name it. This is a stifled market, okay?
Mm.
So that is only when you have a government. You can only have monopolies when there is a government. Because guess what? The government is a monopoly, unless people haven't figured that out. It's a joke, yeah. Isn't it? That they say, oh, the government's got a monopolies commission to make sure no monopolies exist, when in fact it is in a monopoly in its own right.
Yes, because you can't have two governments, apparently. You can only have the one.
Yes.
And it's like, well, where's the competition then? And of course, just to say, oh, well, there's a shadow government, the shadow government can't do anything. It's impotent.
Correct.
Until it's in government. And so you really want two governments, because then people would say, and maybe this is an answer, maybe we just come up with a realization that if you say, well, there's this government and this government, and either one are working now, and if that one is trying to do things you don't want, but this one's doing things you do want, and it's already doing them,
yep.
The other one is going to be irrelevant, and it would have to change its game.
Absolutely. This is why everything that comes from government is so rubbish. Nothing that comes from government's any good, because it's got no competition.
Right.
So,
well, that's a really good point.
Yeah.
I might have to make a separate video on that.
Yeah, I think you should. One of your...
one of my monologues.
Richard monologues, I think so.
I should write that down to jog my memory. Monopoly, right.
That's right. You know, so, and of course, because of the government exists, they control the markets, all this regulation, licensing, taxation, all this nonsense, it stifles the free market, kills it off. The free market is on its deathbed at the minute, coughing up blood. It's almost non-existent. We don't even use money in the free market. It's like people start blaming free market capitalism, and I go, how can you blame something that doesn't even exist?
Mm.
Free market capitalism does not exist in any way, shape, or form. So I don't even know how you can blame that. If you've got a government, you are dealing with either socialism or communism, full stop, and just a different degree. So, yeah, so we've figured out price versus value. Let's get into the money thing. I want to try and get all this done within an hour.
Yes.
Are we good for that?
Sorry about it. I'm good.
Excellent stuff. Right, so money basically has to have two parts, which is a person's labor, and it has to have a commodity of intrinsic value, okay, like a gold coin.
Yeah.
Or you can even consider it the fish. So, for example, does the fish have value to me if it's still out there in the sea? Not really. But if someone wants to go out there and catch the fish and bring it back and put it on my plate and cook it and all the rest of it, well, that has value to me, and I don't mind paying for it. So money is actually like a tool of storing a person's time.
Right.
Okay. So there are some good parts to do with money, which is the ability for long-term storage of your time and freedom, because that's what your time is. It's your freedom. Money is a medium of exchange, as we've discussed earlier. Money was portable. So fishes as money, well, that's not very good. Slimy, slippery, and all that stuff, you know.
Smelly. And going off.
It's going to go off. You know, you try buying, you go into a TV shop and you want to buy the latest TV, and you say, well, how many fish is that? And you open your wallet. Do you want mackerels or sardines? It isn't going to work.
No.
So money has got to be portable. It's got to be durable, divisible, and fungible. Now, fungible means that each piece of money is the same as the last piece of money. In other words, if I've got a 1 ounce gold coin in my pocket, it's the same as your 1 ounce coin in your pocket.
Yes.
So we'll go into the limitations of an IOU, because there's a lot of people talking about IOUs, notes, tokens, and they're saying that that's money. It's not.
Okay? And when you say notes, you're talking about printed, what, you know, notes as in pound notes and
something
20
like
pound.
That.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this is not money in any way, shape, or form. It's used as money, but it isn't. Okay. This is basically a contract. Okay, this is a promissory note. So the limitations to IOUs is they are not money. They are, in fact, contracts. All right, that's the difference. Because remember, money, you've handed your gold coin over to the fisherman or whatever. You've got your fish. There's no contract. It's concluded.
Yeah.
Well, an IOU means you're now entering into a contract with somebody. So, for example, I take a look at your microphone there and go, oh, it's a lovely microphone, Matt. Oh,
get off.
I love it. I love the colour. I will buy that from you. And
I've got a purple one if you'd rather.
Oh, you've got a purple
rather.
One.
I've got two
oh,
now.
You're in the market. You're in the market.
No, but that actually is Julia's, so you can't have that one. But this one, what are you going to offer
oh,
me?
Oh, well, I am going to offer you an IOU.
Oh, really?
That's right.
It's not the same as money, is it?
It's not, is it?
No.
I'm going to put down a piece of paper. I'm just going to write down on a piece of paper, I owe you, and then I'm going to give you a piece of paper that says I owe you on it, and then I'm going to take your microphone.
Oh, thanks very much. I've got the paper. it's this against this, which... Let's see if this works.
No, that's it.
Testing, 1, 2, 3. Can you hear me? So it's not quite doing the same as what this is doing.
It's not at all, is it?
And it's a bit of paper that I don't know now what to do with. That's the thing.
Yes, that's right. It has no value to anybody else. Okay, because I've made a contract with you. I said I owe you something, okay?
Yes.
But we are now in contract until I honour the IOU. So you've got that piece of paper then. That could sit on your desk for decades.
So could I say to you, actually, I'd like you now to cut my hair? And I'm claiming on this. And
yes.
You go, well, that's a nice, easy one.
Yeah, I'll take
First, you've got to find it.
I'll take that deal.
Or you've got this IOU. I'd like you to rebuild my house in a nice country park.
Yes, absolutely.
And you're probably likely to say, I don't know, that's not worth the same as a microphone, is it?
Well, this is absolutely right. I mean, here's the thing as well. Is when I say to you, I owe you, what exactly am I owing you?
Yeah.
Now, I could say time. Let's say I say, I'm going to owe you 1 hour for your microphone. You
right.
might take that deal, right? And then you'll say something like, okay, I want you to use that hour and I want you to cut my hair. And I'll say, well, I'm not a barber. So...
I mean, I made it easy to start with, but you're not a barber. I don't want you scalping me at the same time.
So yeah, so they might say, well, I'm not a barber, so I'm going
right.
to give you 1 hour of something else, and you go, well, okay then. There's a tile. It's on my roof, and it's fixing. I go, yeah, but I'm not a tiler. I'm not a roofer.
So we're coming back to the problem of the barter thing again.
There you go. This is easy, this, isn't it? This economics game. You don't need a degree in economics to understand how this works.
No, and it's fun. It's fun too. But so you could end up ages and ages trying to work out what the hell can I get out of Sovereign Pete to get this, to get the value. And I suppose also it's the value of what I think this is worth.
Yes.
Because if there's a scarcity of blue microphones, then that puts the value up.
Yep.
But there might not have been a scarcity when you bought it from. There may have been hundreds of them.
Yep.
But now there's only one left, and you say, actually, the value of the microphone's gone up, but has this changed?
Yes, exactly.
And I guess it depends on what the contract... what was written on it. If you said it's an hour of my time in exchange for that, you'd think, well, I didn't get a good deal on that.
No, absolutely not. So that's the limitations of IOUs, because you've got to say, well, what is it that I am owing you? Okay.
Mm.
And of course, I am entering into a contract. So as long as everyone understands now that IOUs, including promissory notes and all of these, are contracts you are entering into. So let's talk about tokens, all right? Because a lot of people get mixed up with this as well about tokens, and that a token has value. It doesn't. Okay. A token represents something of value. It doesn't have any intrinsic value of its own. And this is where
Hence the word token itself.
Exactly. They're literally telling you.
It's a token of the value rather than the value.
That's right. That's right. Now, if I bring this up, this is a pound coin. Now, I don't actually like using the terminology coin because it isn't. Because this coin doesn't actually have any intrinsic value. It is in fact a token. This is a token. The metal content of this coin is about 3 pence in value. Yeah. And
we all think, we've got a handful of those. You all think we're quite well off.
Yep.
But actually, it's not, barely worth £1.
Exactly right.
River.
Everyone thinks it's worth £1, but I go, no, the metal is about 3p.
Yeah.
It might have gone up a little bit with inflation, but that's it. I mean, we've got a genuine coin here. This is silver.
That's a nice one.
Yeah, that's a silver coin. All right, now
Hand
that is
over.
A coin. Yeah, there you go. Do you want that for the microphone?
Now you're talking.
But this has got intrinsic value.
Yes.
So it's the metal content itself. It's the commodity.
Mind you, it's got the king's head on it, so I'm not so happy about that.
I know.
But otherwise, I could melt it down.
Yes, you could. But the silver itself is the value. But that is a coin.
Yeah.
That is a token. And here we go. I think we've got 50 pence here. That, again, that's a token.
Yeah.
So the way tokens work is, now, if I take these coins and I go to France and I say, can I have a croissant? And I give them that. No, we don't take that.
Mm.
And you go, well, that's right. They shouldn't, because this is a token. And it's also called legal tender. Whereas if I go to France and I've got a silver coin and I say, can I have a croissant for a silver coin? They'll probably take that.
Yeah, I think they will. They see you coming, won't they? Yeah. Especially if they're worth about 30 quid.
Yeah, they are.
In today's money.
That's quite an expensive croissant.
That must be a lovely croissant. Oh, yes, we'll take that, certainly. We'll even put butter on it for you. Now get out.
So this should actually give people a clue as to what's going on. Because if this 50p only works within the UK, remember, UK is a corporation, but it doesn't work in France and it doesn't work in America, then it's not money at this point. It's a token. Now,
it's a token, yeah.
If I explain it in poker chips, so if you go to Vegas and obviously if you go into a casino and you will get £1,000 and your dollars or whatever, and they'll give you some poker chips, right? And you're in one casino. It's got value, or it represents a value in that jurisdiction of that casino.
Yes.
But if I walk out of that casino and I go into a different one with those poker chips, they don't work in another casino.
No.
So those tokens are worthless. Okay. So that should give you a clue that we are all working or operating within different corporations. So when you go on holiday to France, it's not the land you're moving to. You're moving to a different jurisdiction or a different casino.
Yes.
That accepts different tokens.
I do like the way that you phrase that, because I think that does give people a concept of how much we are gambling in these different systems. When, if you think of everything with corporations as a casino, they run it and they'll give you the tokens and the fake money to play the game, their game, which is always loaded in their way. And then you go to another one. That's a very brilliant way of phrasing it, Pete. I think that's very good. Because I think that really sums it up, because it just shows you that we are in these systems or these casinos, which are very, very loaded, and they have their own rules. But it's intrinsically not money that I could go from one casino to another casino and share.
Yep, that's absolutely right. This is right. And this is why you have an exchange now. So if you go on holiday, you're exchanging. And that should give you another clue. You go, well, hang on a minute.
One set of tokens for another set.
Exactly. I mean, a lot of this stuff is in your
It's not
head.
Money.
It's not money. Yeah, why would I have to exchange this silver coin for another silver coin? You don't. This
no.
is fungible. So it doesn't matter where I am on the planet, this is always going to be worth some money because it's silver.
And because it's pure... it's got a universal gauge of how of its purity and its weight. They're the two things that make it the value.
Absolutely right.
Or make it into money. Yeah,
that's right. Absolutely right.
Because these tokens, as you say, I mean, it's interesting. My daughter came back from New Zealand, and they have, if I've got this right, they have a pound coin size coin, I think, in Australia that's worth $2.
Mm-hmm.
And theirs is the £2 size coin that's worth one. So when Australians come over, what's £2 to one is £1 in size. So they said, we have to be very sharp on what the dollar is, because they're both called dollars.
Yeah.
But we have to be aware because they're two different sizes. Now, if I've got that wrong, I apologize. But that's what Georgie was telling me when she came back. And I thought, well, you know, this is madness, isn't it?
It is. It is. But people just got to wake up and see it. Like, it's in front of your face.
Yeah.
That's all I do. Is you've seen the film They Live, when you put the sunglasses on and then suddenly you can see all what the aliens are doing and you see all the signs. That's what I do. I give people the sunglasses.
Yeah.
And I just explain how it works. So, yeah, if you're doing an exchange, if you're going on holiday, you've got to go to an exchange. Well, you're not exchanging money, are you? You're exchanging tokens.
Yes.
So that covers notes. Yeah, notes. This is actually a financial instrument. Okay. This is not money at all. In fact, it doesn't belong to you. So if you've been given one of those, it actually belongs to the Bank of England. It says so. This is the Bank of England's note. Okay. So we can cover cash and legal tender, but what I do want to do is just want to get into this fiat currency note, and I want to explain the dangers of this. Okay. Because I know a lot of people are saying going cashless is bad, which it is. Okay. But the cash itself isn't much better.
Right. Yeah, no, absolutely. Behind me, I'm getting a bit embarrassed now. There is a cash is king
Yes.
sign here. And what you've just told me, of course, reminded me really, is that if those notes actually belong to the Bank of England, at any time they can say, I'll have them back, please.
Yes.
And you go, well, they're mine, isn't it? No, they're not yours. Presumably.
Absolutely.
I mean, there would be absolute chaos if they did it, you know, and they said, well, we want it all back. People would be shaking their fists. But all the time, they have some sort of big brute blokes with batons and things. They can get away with whatever they want.
Yes. So the thing with these, because they're not yours and they never will be, okay, the bank controls them. And it's a private bank, by the way. So these are basically nothing more than tokens, if you like, of a perceived value. And there is no value here at all. There's none. There's no value. It's not backed by anything. If we have got time, we can cover the difference between backed by and pegged too. So, but I just want to cover this fiat currency stuff first.
No, do carry on.
So this is a note. It's a financial instrument, and you don't own it. So the problem with these is, first of all, you don't own it. Okay, the bank does. Also, if you use these for payments, it is a promise to pay, but you are not the one making the promise to pay. It is the Bank of England making the promise to pay. So, for example, if I wanted to buy your microphone and I gave you some of these, well, it's such a lovely microphone. It's
I know, you're so
color brilliant.
kind. You're so kind. It's a lovely blue. I must covet it more. I must look after it. So, didn't realize it was so popular.
Going to be popular. That it is. I mean, once I bought it from you, I can sell it on eBay and say, this is Richard Robes's actual microphone.
Yeah, now upscale it, you
Upscaling, you
swine.
see.
I don't know.
And
it's got his spittle all over it. Lovely.
oh, DNA, you see, you get your fans wanting the DNA.
Yeah, that's it. Certainly a deep state wants it. Anyway.
So, yeah, you're probably giving it away by now anyway. So, anyway, so these notes. So, because it's the Bank of England that's making the promise to pay, and I buy your microphone, it is the Bank of England that's made the promise, not you, or in this case, me. I haven't made the promise to pay. That means I don't own it. So, it might be in my possession, the microphone, but it's the Bank of England's note that I've used, and it's them who are saying I've promised to pay. They've got the ownership of it. So, this is why Klaus Schwab can turn around and say, you'll own nothing and be happy, because no one owns anything at all. You know, I mean, I don't even need to get into the all caps name and the registration and all the rest
I
of it.
guess if you offered it me with your silver coin,
Oh, yes.
you'd own it.
There you go. There you go. Now,
So
I would own it if I bought it with this.
yes.
Correct.
And I guess people could turn round and say, I mean, if they keep receipts, that's the proof that they've bought it using fiat currency.
Ah, not quite.
Ah,
Yeah, you've got to
okay.
be careful with receipts. A receipt just means you've received something. It doesn't really go into great detail into what. This is where the legal system steps in and complicates things a lot.
Right,
Um,
okay.
because when you're dealing in commerce, and unfortunately, if you're dealing with paperwork, you know, log books for your car, land registry, and all of this stuff, you are dealing with their paperwork. But what you've got within ownership, there's multiple titles in ownership. All right, you've got rights in ownership. You've got certificates of. So, it's like for a car. If you sell your car to me and we use the V5, you might give me a receipt, and it might even say, you know, receipt £10,000 for one, whatever. But all that receipt covers is the legal right to use the car, i.e., becoming the registered keeper. It's not ownership of the car. The reason
Right.
being, you never had the right to sell it in the first place
Oh, I see.
because you didn't have all the rights. You didn't have the deed to it. You didn't have all the titles to it, you didn't have all the rights to it, and you didn't have all the certificates to it. all you had in your possession was the right to drive it as the registered keeper. So when you write out a receipt to say that you sold the car, no, you just transferred the registered keeper title.
Would that be the same with this microphone? If you buy this microphone, regardless of whether you buy it with the fiat currency or the silver coin, it may be, if I bought the microphone originally, because I didn't make it with fiat currency, it was never mine in the first place to sell it to you.
Yes, now you.
But if I
it.
Bought it with, then you get into the how do you the proof of ownership.
Correct.
If I've made the microphone myself, and it would not necessarily be as pretty as this, then I could say I've made it. I don't know whether, you say, well, did you make the metal? That you how much of it do you have to go into? But yeah, I can follow that.
Yes.
So it's interesting what you say there, just going back to the basic point of the fact that if you pay it in banknotes, you even then you still don't own it.
You don't. I mean, what's worse as well is if it's got a serial number, if your microphone's got a serial number on it, which you may do.
I'm just going to turn the volume down so I can have a look.
There will be a manufacturer's statement of origin somewhere that relates to that serial number. So someone will actually hold that serial number.
There is. There's a bloody serial number.
There you go.
And it's not cornflakes.
No.
That's a fascinating insight in and of itself.
Yes. So.
Gosh.
The fiat notes trap. I'll just cover a lot of things. Don't forget.
Yeah.
You don't buy anything with this. Okay. You haven't paid for anything with this. There's also inflation in this because the Bank of England keeps printing them out. So this gets devalued.
Yes.
You've got depreciation. You've also got taxation. Remember, you are using the Bank of England's promissory note. They own it. So that's why they tax you, because it's the tax for using it. So you're getting taxed on your own money, so to speak. Stamp duty is another one. If you buy your house with these... Okay, new notes are created when you sign off on the mortgage contract, right, which converts your private credit into public credit. There's a physical stamp, although I don't think they do the stamp anymore, but there used to be in olden days a physical stamp on the note, and then you would have to pay for that, the administration of the note. That's where stamp duty comes from when you buy a house.
It's a complete and utter con.
It really is. This is an absolute evil, evil thing. And it sucks the wealth out of you. This is not money. It does not work as like money at all. Actually, if we've got time, we can cover loans.
Mm.
Yes, because obviously now we know that this is a promissory note. Banks do not loan money because they don't deal in money. They deal in these notes. They're actually a facilitator of credit. That's what they do. And what they are actually doing is when you go in there and you want to take out a loan, which it isn't even a loan, so they're actually fraudulent at that, to calling it a loan. They take your private credit, which you create with a stroke of a pen. So you'll sign on a document. You've created the credit out of thin air. It's your credit.
They will that credit is what? Because of the contract to promise to pay back, say, a mortgage?
Well, it's actually accessing your Sesta KV trust when you were born. This is all tied to the birth certificate. It does get complicated, and we can save that for another time if you will.
Because
that's another two-hour presentation.
Absolutely.
But it's actually, you sign off on it and you're basically allowing the mortgage company to gain access to your trust fund, which is where all your credits are, if you like. You've got about $100 million of credits in there. And then the mortgage company converts your private credit into this, which is called public credit. And then they give it to you. You buy your house and you end up paying this back at interest. And it's a complete and utter scam. Now, we can touch on obligation to pay. Because there's a lot of people, especially with the cashless, a lot of people are saying businesses don't have to take cash, which is actually true. Cash is a slang word. It's not doesn't really have any legal or lawful binding connotations to it. Legal tender is what people should be using. This is legal tender. Okay.
Yes.
Now, legal tender, legal means contract, and tender means I will tend to the debt in the future. So this is a promise to pay, legal tender. That's what it means. I'm entering into a contract with you and I am promising to tend to the debt in the future. All registered businesses are required to take this. There's a lot of misinformation out there saying, no, they don't have to. Yes, they do, because they've accepted the contract to accept these once they've registered. Once you register to the UK, the corporation, you have agreed to use the promissory notes or the casino of the Bank of England. You have to.
Right. Okay? So you could go into that little store that says it's cashless.
Yep.
And you can go in there and say, here we go, I'd like to pay. And then they say, well, sorry, mate, we're cashless. Or, did you register this business in the UK? Yes. Then I'm sorry to say that you are obliged.
Yes. Yes. Now, the shop can take anything in payment, and they have that right. So if you go in with a silver coin, you're going to Lidl's and say, I'd like to pay with a silver coin. Now, they can refuse that. Okay, because they're not required to accept it through contract, you see.
Right.
But they can accept it. It's their choice. You can say, well, can I pay with fish? And they go, yeah, we'll take your fish.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I'll wash your dishes if I have to pay, you know, all that sort of stuff.
They've got that right. But if you offer legal tender, so you've got to take this. Now, legal tender is not debit cards or credit cards. Okay, because that is private credit. That's your, every time you use a debit card or every time you use a credit card, even if you write a check, what you're actually doing is you're creating brand new private credit, which is not being converted into public credit yet. Therefore, the shops are not liable to take it. They're not liable to take your private credit. It has to be converted into one of these promissory notes. Then they have to. Now, going back, you said something earlier saying cash is king.
Yeah, I've got the embarrassing sign now. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to make it not embarrassing anymore.
Oh, good. I'm very pleased to hear that, because I was getting a bit worried then, because you know, the people, we're in this situation where they're trying to make us cashless, and as you say, cash is a term that's not legally binding to anything. It's, we've assumed it means something.
Yeah.
I.e., legal tender, which is in our hand and in our pockets and private.
Yes. Yes. Well, technically, the use of these is private, but the actual, they're not private because they're the Bank of England's, you know, so they're not, it's not like your money or something like that. I mean, this, you know, if it was a genuine silver coin, there would be no bank behind it. Okay. It would be just, that's it. It's been created.
Because in and of itself, it has the intrinsic value and it stands alone.
It stands alone. So,
yeah.
Okay. Now, the cash is king bit is, this is why a lot of people get this wrong and they don't understand how things work. Back in the day, it would be, this is called fiat currency, which means by decree. And you go, okay, then who's making the decree? It would be the king. And of course, in fact, we've got the king's head or face on that coin there, right?
Yeah.
And there'll be a reason for that, because it would be considered the king's money. And everyone within his kingdom has to take it. You cannot refuse the king's money. That would be treason, and in most cases, it's get your head chopped off. So the term cash.
So the people at Lidl, you better watch out.
Yes, absolutely.
You don't want to have your head chopped off because, you know, you've taken the king's money.
Absolutely. You've got to take it. They have to take it. They're legally required. But the term cash is king, the reason where that came from is because the king says so.
Right.
Yeah, the king is saying, this is money.
Yeah.
Okay, that's it. That's that. Now, I do know, obviously, the UK is a corporation. It is stealing a lot of stuff from England. England is another corporation, okay? These are different jurisdictions. Same with Britain. That's another jurisdiction. That's another corporation. They're all fighting at the minute. And the UK is trying to steal all this jurisdiction, stealing it from the King of England. Don't need to go into any of that. But the term cash is king basically means the king says so. Now, if people turn around and say, well, I'm not taking this anymore, what do you think happens to the value of this?
Well, it'll just become, worthless. Sweet wrapping.
That's absolutely
couldn't,
right.
You couldn't even use it for chip wrappers, because unless it's just one or two chips.
Absolutely right. Absolutely
and it's plastic,
right.
And it's horrible.
Absolutely right. So what will happen is if the shops were allowed to reject legal tender, then that means the legal tender of that particular country is now worthless, because no one's backing it up. Because if the shops and the businesses operating within that corporate country don't want to take the legal tender and don't have to, then that's the end of it. It's valueless. It collapses. The currency collapses. It's end of. And also, I just want to touch on central bank digital currencies, a little...
Oh, yes. I can't wait for those to come in. Oh, they sound lovely. A bit of programming of your money and social credit. I can't wait. Great fun.
Well, there is a silver lining.
Oh,
central
okay.
bank digital currency. Because central bank digital currency is a different monetary system. It's not this. Now, if you've
Right.
got a debt, and I'm using the word debt in quotes, using these fiat notes, okay, and then they switch. Say you might have a house and you might have a 1.5 million pound mortgage using these, and then the government switches to central bank digital currencies. What do you think is going to happen to your debt? It's going to evaporate. It's gone.
Is it?
Disappears. Gone.
So
Because.
people who have mortgages have a lot to look forward to then.
Yes, for a short period.
Ah.
Now, here's the thing.
Until they actually come to do something, because you can't, I can't believe that a government would want that to continue.
No, they're not going to tell you this. They are not going to tell you this. They're going to try and make the transition and hope no one notices.
Right.
That's what they're going to try and do. But the word is out. This is everyone within the financial system. If they know their stuff, if they understand economics, then you'll know that your debt is actually in these or American dollars or Canadian notes or whatever it
So
is.
you're saying they can't change it into a different monetary system?
No, because it's changing. What's going on is they can't legally do it. Okay? Because what's happening is if they try and do the central bank digital currency, the original debt contracts are null
Yeah.
and void. You
Oh, I
can't
see.
change a debt contract without the permission of the debtor. Okay?
Oh, right. I understand.
Yeah. So you've got the bank has to come back to me. Let's say I've got a 1.5 million pound mortgage.
Yeah.
Okay. The mortgage company has to contact me and says, okay, we're changing, we're not using fiat anymore. And I know your old debt was in fiats. Fiat notes, we're not using that anymore. We have now switched to central bank digital currencies, and we would like to move the debt over from the fiat over to the central bank digital currency. But they need my permission. Guess what my answer would be? No, thank
Sod
you.
off. Yeah. And presumably this central bank, this is a one world central bank.
It is. It is.
So even the countries and the banks within it sort of all lose out.
All of them. All of them, credit card companies, student loan.
So it can't really happen.
It can't happen. They're going to try and make it happen. What they're hoping to do, the people who want to do this, the cabal, if you like, they hope no one notices.
Well, you noticed.
Yep.
And now the viewers of this will notice. So anybody watching this, if it ch changes over, well, you kind of hope that it does for a while. You can say, no,
Just for a while.
I'm not switching that over. Thanks very much. I'll pay it
Small.
back in the worthless fiat currency that you've just now made worthless. So basically, I can't pay it back because I
It's
scraps of
apples and
newspaper would be worth more.
yeah, it's apples and oranges. If I've got a debt to you for apples and I owe you apples, you can't come back to me and say, well, I've changed the contract, I now want oranges.
Yes.
No, that my contract with you is with apples. But if the fiat system's dead, they're not, it's not worth anything. Now, here's the
Right.
thing as well about the central bank digital currency is if enough people knew this and enough people says, oh, right, all my debts go away, all my car loans and all the rest of it, guess what happens to the actual central bank digital currency? It collapses. Why? Because what they are trying to do, the people behind the banking system, they've got all this debt. Their debt, they've got an upside down system. The debt in the financial system is what they consider an asset, the value. It's in the quadrillions. They want to try and take that debt and they want to move it into the central bank digital currency system to give it some value, okay? They can't do that if we turn around and say, well, hang on a minute, all that debt is in fiat and we're not using fiat anymore. So without the
Yeah.
debt, they've got nothing of intrinsic, not
So
intrinsic value.
yet again, they need us to acquiesce, like
Absolutely.
all these things. And unfortunately, a load of people will be frightened
Yep.
and will acquiesce. But if not, if enough people say no, it will make that debt not realize that they won't get the value they wanted to get. If, I don't know, 20% of the population of the world say no,
Yes.
they're going to go, oh, crikey, that didn't work very well. We'll
It
have to frighten
collapses.
them with something else.
It collapses. This is why I try and say to people the system is so fragile, it's unbelievable.
So what about, could I ask you then about Bitcoin
Yep.
and crypto, just briefly?
Yeah, we're kind
Because a lot of people say, oh, this is where we should be going. It's clearly it's a digital version
of.
of a gold coin or a silver coin?
No. It's useful, don't get me wrong. I do think crypto has a place. I see it as a useful service. Now, I'm going to give you some three, I'm going to call it, let's call it Pete's postulates.
Right? Pete's postulates. I wish I had a zany sort of thing now that could come in.
Pete's postulates.
So this is cheap YouTube version here, so I'm we'll sorry I haven't got it, Pete.
On the screen or something.
Yeah.
Now, these are three things that anyone can do to see if what you're dealing with is money.
Right.
These are the three postulates. It's got to fulfill these three postulates. So number one, does it involve someone's labor? Okay, so that's the first one. Is someone's labor involved in the thing that I'm being offered? Okay, so you can.
Right.
Okay, now I'll just go through these three postulates and then we'll apply it to crypto. The next one is, does it have intrinsic value, a physical commodity, you know, a fish or an apple or silver, a physical thing that I can hold in the real world, a physical intrinsic commodity? That's number two. And the third one, which is the most important, is there any third party risk?
Right.
Right. Is there a third party involved? Now, if there is a third party involved, i.e., this, and we have it down as the Bank of England, we now know the Bank of England is involved in all our trades.
Yeah.
That's the third party risk, because they can devalue this at any moment. They can get rid of this note. That's the third party risk. So that's the three postulates. So let's apply it to any crypto. Is there labor involved? Well, yeah, you could say Bitcoin, someone had to build the computers and they have to sit.
And they have to have these miners, don't they?
Yeah, the miners.
Quite why they got kids involved, I don't know, but there we are. But they've, you know, kids are good on computers. No, but they have to, in order to keep the blockchain working, as I understand it, they have to have these machines actually running.
Yes.
So there's electricity, there's keeping it off the, you know, where it can't be tampered with, and
that's
they're
right.
all over the bloody world. Right.
That's right. You've got to set it up. You know, you've got to, someone's got to take time. They've got to set up all their computers, wire it up, all that sort of stuff. So you go, yes, there's definitely labor involved. The next one, does it have intrinsic value? That's a difficult one, because I would say no. It's not physical, is it?
No.
It's not a physical commodity, but it has value. Because remember, value is in the eye of the beholder. So the use of Bitcoin has a value. So I would consider it a service rather than a thing of value, you know, intrinsic.
Yeah.
Like having your hair cut. You know, the service, and me too. The service is valuable, but there's no physical commodity.
Right.
Okay? And then the third one, is there third party risk? Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, that's an obvious one. I mean, if there's no internet, if there's no, you know, if I don't have a device, if I don't have a computer, if I don't have the network.
For me, that's the killer thing is. And it's, and all those things can be nobbled. You know, you may not be able to, as they say, you might not be able to get into the code and stuff, but if you're able to have a blackout, or if there's one of those colon injection things from the sun that wipes out, you know, but whereas your bit of silver still, unless you have a fire so intense that it dribble, but even then you might be able to find the dribbles and put it back and
remelt
it. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, it, as you say, a useful tool for short-termism.
Yes, for long-distance trading, maybe.
Yeah.
You know, if I wanted to buy something in China, in the free market, you know, and I don't want to use fiat, then I would say absolutely use a crypto.
Yeah.
Because it's just very good. It's a good service. It's a good tool. But when people say it's a digital gold, no, it isn't.
Right. No, I can. And in my gut, I felt there was something. It's not all into it, whereas I can see what silver is or gold, or you know, something that's physical, because and even fish, you know, obviously not for long term, but in that immediate situation where you may have nothing else and you've only got that guy with the basket, and by golly you need a basket to carry the amount of fish I've got, then you know, it is something immediate. But for me, one of the most important things is nobody needs to bloody know.
Yes.
They're not.
This is private.
You know, nosing about, and it's untrackable. I just give it to you. You take my microphone, and I wish I'd
Yes.
And all of that. This has been absolutely, this has been an amazing walkthrough, and I knew it would could be that simple, because you explain these things in very clearly constructed, thought out modules, if you like, which makes it very interesting.
I hope it made it clear for everybody. I hope everyone understands what money is now.
Do you think then, going into the future with our undecided futures, that we still have the fiat currency and but of course it's got control of the government and stuff, but in an ideal world, should we then be dealing in gold and silver and fishes, or you know, whatever is in the eye of the beholder at that particular, whatever is useful? Is that where we should be?
That's what I would prefer, a free market of money. It's up to the individual what they choose. You know, I don't mind doing barter. I'll do that. I've swapped things before. That's what barter is, you know.
Yeah.
But I think gold and silver is the gold standard.
That's
the
absolutely.
Foundation of an economy.
Yeah.
So, but you can't have modern day barter without money and an economy supporting it. Because we can't swap TVs and microphones without that economy that uses money who built them in the first place. They're not fishes and baskets. Yeah, because there's so many people involved in building it. You can't use barter to make a TV.
No. And presumably, even within the market itself, there would have to be certain restrictions, because there's only a limited of raw supply of raw materials that you could get. You know, there may be enough material in the world to make a billion microphones, but there might not be enough material to make a billion and one. Yes. So things will be limited by natural supply. And at the same time, of course, you wouldn't want to deplete, say, the world of very rare minerals to make electric batteries for EV cars if at the end of the day nobody's using them, or you can't charge them up. Why would you do that?
Correct.
So the market would slowly sort itself out, because
it does.
People, free market.
You're absolutely right. The free market sorts itself out. We only have this twisted market because it's controlled by governments. We don't have a third world because of governments. If there was no governments, you wouldn't have a third world. Everyone would have a very high standard of living. You wouldn't have electric cars in a free market. There's no way. Mm. So electric cars only exist because they're being forced upon us and because they're being subsidized. Okay, this is not a free market. This is a controlled and manipulated market. But that's right. Yeah. The invisible hand of the free market is the commodity itself. That's the limitations. So,
fantastic. Now, Pete, before we let you go, I know I just want to put up, first of all, that graphic that we did, just to remind people that the Sovereign Project Conference is taking place, and to get your tickets somewhere online, presumably. And all the information is there, and I'll copy that and put it into the description.
Lovely.
But also, you have something else happening. Let me get rid of that. And this is something, your wiki. Tell us about that.
Oh, thanks. Yes. What we're trying to do is, I get dozens and hundreds and probably thousands of emails, people contacting me saying, oh, can you check my paperwork? Have you got a template? What's the remedy for this? Unfortunately, I can't answer all these emails. So what we're trying to do is set up the Sovereign Wiki. And the idea is everyone can get involved. Okay, if you've got something to say, if you've got some templates, if you've got some remedies, if you've got some information you want to share, you can use the wiki and put it up on there for free, and anyone can use it. So the idea is it's going to be like a legal, lawful, truth movement, freedom movement, call it what you will, wiki that anyone can use. So, and it's going to be free for as long as I can afford it.
Yeah, brilliant. And have you got an address for that, or is it that to follow?
Yep, there is an address. The easiest way to find it is we've put a button on the sovereignproject.live website. And there is actually on the homepage, you'll see a big yellow button and it says Sovereign Wiki. And we've made it so simple. You just click on that and it takes you there.
Yeah, I'm just going to shove it on the screen here.
Yep.
Because I found
there it
earlier.
Is.
There it is.
Sovereign Wiki.
And the big Where are we looking for the...
That's it. No, it says the Sovereign Wiki. Just below, you go a bit down.
Oh, yeah, there it is. Right in front of my face. There That's we it. Go. So Big just button. Click on that and away you go.
And it takes you to the Sovereign. There it is. And we've got some stuff on there already. And people are beginning to use it. And I want more and more people to get involved. So...
And it's a brilliant resource. Brilliant stuff, Pete, as ever. Absolutely fantastic. I think people will have got a lot out of that. I certainly have. I've got a good monologue coming up about monopoly governments and why we need two or three other governments.
Yeah.
So that they can, I think that would, I just got to think it through.
Yeah, think that one through.
But how brilliant is that? If we want a government at all, that is.
I don't.
There you are.
I think a government of an individual. We should be our own government.
Exactly. There you go. Yeah. I like that. We must get you back on the show again in due course. I'm sure we will, because you are a man of great knowledge.
Thank you.
And we really appreciate it. And as I say, people can find your website. I'll leave the link in there. The sovereignproject.live, I think you said it was.
Yep.
Something like that. But it'll all be in there, and I'll put the event details as well. Pete, thank you so much. Absolutely marvellous. Really enjoyed it.
That's all. Good talking to you. See you, Richard.
Take care. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching. Don't forget to follow, like and subscribe and all those usual things. I'll be back with more interviews and monologues, one on monopolies and government. Until next time, thanks for watching from Pete and I. Goodbye.